we know, no one ever had to teach us that life is sacred. And recently, we saw a global affirmation of the sacredness of life. And the video of George Floyd went out and was seen by billions. The justified outcry, whether we realize it or not, was a global affirmation that life is sacred. In that moment, when that life was taken, and we saw that, no one had to teach us that's wrong. We know that because God's law is in our hearts. We cried out, murder is evil, and the whole globe, atheist or believer, knows that, and cried out for the sanctity of human life when we saw that murder happen. And sadly, George Floyd's death has spawned so many cancerous spin-offs, cancel culture and rioting and anti-police movements and more violence and political posturing and virtue signaling and bickering, that we almost forget that underneath it all is the sin of murder. All the disagreement and polarization has clouded out that initial tragic truth that life is sacred. All human life is sacred. And sadly, things are so touchy right now in our world that if a person says, as I just did, life is sacred and all human life matters, then that statement, which is completely true and has been said from pulpits here and across the world for 2,000 years, now puts you in a camp. If you say all lives matter, now that is interpreted to mean that you don't believe in things like police brutality and systemic racism, or that you don't care about real injustices that minorities face. And conversely, if you say black lives matter, then you supposedly don't care about blue lives who stand in harm's way. And you supposedly endorse lawlessness and rioting and all kinds of stuff that you probably don't mean when you say black lives matter. Church, we need to be wise right now to see and to know and to remember that there is an enemy in this world. There is a demonic spirit in this world that takes grains of truth and spins them every which way to obscure what is true and good and to perpetuate division, hatred, lawlessness, and hardness of heart. So we need to be a people that says every life is sacred. That's been the proclamation of the people of God for millennia. And when black lives have been counted in the laws of our nation as 3/5 of a human life, and when black lives are statistically and anecdotally more at risk of unwarranted violence, then we as a church need to unashamedly say, yes, black lives matter, because all lives matter. See, it's not either or. It's both and. When a black life is ended so publicly and horrendously, that's not really the time to say all lives matter. That's the time to say there's injustice against black lives and black lives matter. But then when that thinking goes berserk and creates a movement that then privileges black lives against other lives, then we need to say, no. All lives matter, because every life is sacred. Let's be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to admit that we don't understand everything. But just because we don't understand everything doesn't mean we don't understand anything. All human life is sacred. It bears the image of God. This isn't about a movement or putting yourself in a camp or an either-or. It's about the truth that God has created human life holy, sacred, and beautiful. Throughout the history of the church, from the moment that new DNA is conceived in the womb until a person's last breath, the people of God has said, that life is sacred. a lawless murder makes the news, as it should. The church also needs to be a place where people, where we speak out for the sanctity of human life, even if it is, quote, lawful. At present, there are 9 states that have what is known as a death with dignity law. Death with dignity. Those words can be very deceptive. What some call death with dignity has historically been called murder, physician-assisted suicide. Church, we need to think about this, because it is most likely coming to a nursing home and hospital near you very soon. In fact, I think that if you're my age or younger, we will be faced with this decision for our parents' good lives. The idols of our culture are ease and comfort and expediency. And it is so easy to believe that the loving thing to do would be to end one's misery with a simple, painless IV. Do not buy that lie. It's murder. It's taking the image of God, the beauty and worth of a human life. But I do want to clarify, I want to be clear that palliative care is a gift from God, purposeful for easing suffering. And also, removing treatment or pulling the plug, as it is sometimes said, of a ventilator or other mode of life support is not the same thing as physician-assisted suicide. To end treatment is simply to surrender to God's timing and will. That's different than to actively take a substance intended to kill life. And church, as crazy as this may sound, it will be tempting. If you sat by the bedside of a loved one suffering from pain, and many in our church have, you know how hard that is. And you know that you reach a point oftentimes where you come to peace with the fact that they are ready to go. And at that point, all you want is their comfort and to ease their pain. But let the people of God resist this temptation. Let us proclaim with our actions that life is sacred until the very end. As hard as those moments can be, there are many in our church family who would say, those were some of the most special moments that I had with my mom or my dad or my family member by their bedside, praying with them, singing to them, reading scripture with them, holding their hand, cherishing the gift of life. And not only that, but let's be wise enough to see where the road of physician-assisted suicide leads. When you start blurring the line and redefining murder as death with dignity, it leads down a dangerous path. It makes life a commodity, where human beings, often those who are financially motivated to do so, are making statistical decisions about who should live and who should not. Many of you know Joanne Widmer, a member of our church family. Joanne is, I'm guessing, about 93 years old. And I remember vividly, I remember the hospital room we were in, praying with her about 5 or 6 years ago. The doctors had told her, this is the end. You're not going to make it. She was in very poor health. And Joanne and I had a friendship, and we talked a little bit as far as she was able to. We were both crying. I held her hands. We prayed. I remember walking out of that room and looking back at her and thinking, that's the last time I'm going to see Joe alive. I remember that. The doctors aren't always right. Joanne graduated from hospice. She got better. She's been living joyfully, and I don't use that word flippantly, joyfully at Westminster Village now for the past 5 or 6 years. In January or February, prior to COVID, I went down to visit her one day. I walked in there, and I went to her room, and she wasn't there. And so I asked the hospital administrator, where's Joanne? And he said, well, I don't know. I'll take her out and let's find her. And he started walking around and asking employees, have you seen Joe? And everybody hadn't seen her, but they all had a good word to say about her. Just like she's a ray of sunshine in that place. We're walking all over this place, and finally, we go to the workout center, and we see Joanne in the weight room. doing her exercises. And I see her and she has a big smile, and we sit down and just have a great chat. Church, don't buy the lie. Physician-assisted suicide is murder. And if that's legal, if someone is financially motivated to do so, it would have been so easy for someone to walk into Joanne's room 5 or 6 years ago and say, I'm gonna put this IV in there. All you have to do is say yes. That's murder. Don't buy that lie. Life is sacred to the very end. It's also sacred at the very beginning. Life in the womb is sacred. I know this is a hard topic for some in our church family who have had abortions or who have encouraged a daughter or a girlfriend to get an abortion, and hopefully you've experienced the healing grace of Jesus Christ. I want that to be loud and clear, that Jesus forgives and heals every sin. Think about Jesus who talked to a sinful woman, Luke chapter 7 says. And she's experiencing his love and mercy and grace and weeping at his feet. And he says, she's loved much because she's been forgiven much. I hope that if you have had an abortion, you've repented of that sin. And you know the mercy and forgiveness of Jesus Christ. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And I pray you know that, and that is gospel truth in your soul. And yet, the thing that makes grace meaningful is truth. The truth that life, as Psalm 139 says, is knit together in the mother's womb, that it's the gift of God, and it's the unanimous testimony not only of church, I should say the near unanimous testimony, not of Scripture, but of the historical church, that life in the womb is sacred. And we know that with modern science, that new DNA is made at conception, and a heartbeat is thumping around 100 beats per minute at 5 to 6 weeks. We can say that life in the womb is sacred and needs to be protected. I want to be a pastor and a Christian and a church that sounds the alarm loud and clear, saying life in and out of the womb is the sacred gift of God. I want to teach that to the next generation, some who may be faced with that choice someday. That the righteous decrees of God would be in the hearts of those in this faith family and in this community, that life in the womb is sacred. Yet, let us not be a people that only talks. In all the issues I've just mentioned, talk is good. Talk is helpful. Sermons are needed. But faith without action is dead. Faith acts. Faith is costly. And I want to encourage us to say, life is sacred, but to live, life is sacred. It should be that if physician-assisted suicide is someday legal here in Illinois, we should be saying that is wrong, that is an evil, and yet those who work at our local nursing homes should be saying, why is it that Christians are the ones that are visiting here all the time? They should be saying things like, I can't imagine doing this job without the local churches, because they are in here loving and caring for the aged all the time. Now that's pro-life. Or rather, we should not merely vote pro-life on a ballot. We should walk alongside those mothers who are faced with really hard, even deceptive choices. The church should be a place more and more of foster care and adoption and of giving financially to places like Hope Pregnancy Center, just like we do with the Baby Bottle Project that you can do right now. You can pick up a bottle and donate funds to the Hope Pregnancy Center in Pontiac. We should not merely be saying, don't have an abortion. We should be saying, and we are here to help. What do you need? You need a place to live? We are here to help. It would seem that many of the abortions that occur in this world happen because a young woman feels trapped and with no other options. Let the Church of Jesus say loudly, we are the other option. How can we help? We want to. I think of a couple in our church who once met a friend in the parking lot of an abortion clinic and tried to talk her out of it and prayed with her and sat in the car praying as she went into that office. But God, I don't understand this, but God allowed her to make that choice and she walked into the clinic. After she walked out, those friends did not abandon her. They continued to walk with her in life and show her the love of Jesus, bring healing and grace, and hopefully prevent that choice from happening again. But when it comes to the polarization surrounding Black Lives Matter, let's not merely talk or post online. Let the message of our lives preach the sanctity of human life, about what is just and good and true. I'm mindful of the police officer I talked to recently in our community. He was assigned to patrol a Black Lives Matter rally. And after the rally sort of ended, one of the women who was speaking out about some things there, a Black woman, the police officer is a white man, they started talking to each other, and he called her by name, and he put his arm on her back, and he said, "You know I got your back, right?" And she said, "I know you do." And the reality is, he knows that woman because he's been to her house 3 or 4 times to protect her life from an abusive boyfriend. And she knows her life matters to this man. They love each other. Despite all the rhetoric, they know that life is sacred. And they're breaking down walls by their graciousness and love to one another. And despite all the horrific things we've seen on the news, there have also been some spots of beauty where white and black have come together and said life is sacred. Church, let not only our talk go out into this world, let our actions, our costly sacrifice, no matter the color, no matter the age, born and unborn, from the womb to the tomb, as it is said, because human life bears the image of God. But now let's look at the law in our own eye, because I mainly talked about out there. But Jesus takes this commandment about not murdering and puts it in our hearts. In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus says this in verse 21. He says, "You have heard that it was said to those of old, 'You shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment.' But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says, 'You fool,' will be liable to the hell of fire." Jesus is so good at this, painfully good at this. He x-rays the human heart. And we have reason to believe from the context of the Sermon on the Mount that there were those in the crowd, like many of us today, who were self-justified and self-righteous. They supposedly kept God's law. They'd never murdered or stolen or committed adultery. And so they thought, "I'm good. I'm moral. I'm in the right." And Jesus said, "Hold on. Not so fast. You may have never murdered someone, but if you hate your brother in your heart, you're guilty of sin and liable to judgment in hell." He didn't mince words. To hate someone who is made in the image of God is to hate someone God loves and created to display His glory. Hatred, bitterness, rage, slander, and malice is not the spirit of love of Jesus Christ. Now, to clarify, Jesus is not saying that hatred is the same as murder. Sometimes well-intended Christians say, "Well, Jesus teaches that if you hate someone, it's the same as murdering them in your heart." That's not what Jesus says. Hatred and murder are not the same thing. I've had people hate me, but I'm thankful they didn't murder me. Hatred and murder have the same root heart condition, but they're different in the degree of seriousness. And Jesus is saying both murder and hatred are sin, and those who are guilty of sin are liable to judgment in hell unless there's repentance and forgiveness. What he's doing is slicing through the self-righteous justification, and he's showing us that just because we've not murdered does not mean we're sinless. We still need a Savior. Jesus is showing that God calls us to way more than a negative morality. A negative morality is the idea that I'm moral because I do not do X, Y, and Z. Negative morality is I check all the thou shalt not boxes, therefore I'm good to go. But Jesus shows that sin is a matter of the heart. Not murdering is a minimum morality, but that's not God's standard of righteousness. That's the bare minimum. God's will for us is not merely to be non-murderers. What did Jesus say? All men will know you are my disciples if you don't murder each other. No. All men will know you are my disciples if you love one another. Faith is more than non-murder. Faith is walking in love. And Jesus calls us to way more than non-murder, but to sacrificial love for one another. Paul, in Romans chapter 13, you can turn there if you'd like. Romans chapter 13, verse 8, shows us how love fulfills all the commandments. Romans 13, 8. The one who loves another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in the word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. Say that again. Love is the fulfilling of the law. Love is the call to every follower of Jesus. Galatians 5:1. Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself for us. 1 John 3:7, Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God. If we don't love, we can say whatever we want, but if we don't love, we don't know God. And of course, Matthew 5, this one's a dagger. Jesus said, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. He goes on to say, if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles who don't know God do the same? That'll hit home if we let it. Jesus is saying, what good is it if people who wear masks love people who wear masks? Don't even the pagans do that? What good is it if police officers love fellow police officers? Don't Gentiles do that? What good is it if black NBA players love black NBA players? What good is it if parents who do at-home learning love parents who do at-home learning? What good is it if white-collar job people love other people with white-collar jobs? What good is it if people who listen to Rush Limbaugh love people who listen to Rush Limbaugh? What good is it if people in the union love people who are in the union? What good is it if people who love Bible study love people who Bible study? What good is it if we love those who are just like us? Jesus says, that takes zero faith. Pagans do that. That's not love. The kingdom of Jesus is a kingdom of radical love. We don't love people because they're lovely. We love people because God has poured out his love to the unlovely. That's the gospel. That while we were still sinners in the depths of our sin, God the Father lavished love on us by sending his Son, Jesus Christ, to graciously love sinners. This is the kingdom of Jesus. This is the king that we follow. The king of radical love to the other. Jesus Christ bore a cross, bled and died as a sacrifice for our sins, and that love is unconditional and sacrificial. It's not because we were worthy of it. And astoundingly, the Son of God, while being murdered on a cross, looked at his murderers and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's love. That's the king that we follow today. That's the king of radical love and forgiveness. So let's not be a people who claim that love and forgiveness from God and love that, but don't give that love and forgiveness to others in this world. And so in view of the sixth commandment today, my question is not, do you need to repent of murder? My question is, are you walking in love? For love is the fulfillment of the law. And because Jesus is the only one who's perfectly walked in love, we all need to diagnose our hearts prayerfully and say, Lord, help me to walk in love. Show me where I need to repent of selfishness and sin and whatever else is in there that is not of the Spirit of Jesus. Diagnose your heart. When you hear hatred or bitterness, is there a name that pops into your mind? Now, for many, for some, maybe not. But for others, there may be a name that jumps to mind right away, and you need to pray for God to soften your heart. You can love a person who's not lovely. Is there someone in your life you've not forgiven? Maybe you have a hard heart toward them, and maybe even worse, you're okay with that. You've just been living your life. You've written them off. It's not the Spirit of Jesus. While being murdered, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's the King we follow. What about your family? Do you love them like Galatians 5:1 says, where Jesus gave himself up to them, he poured himself out? Or are you selfish? How selfish? Maybe a better question. Would parents, would siblings, would your spouse, if you're married, would children say, yeah, they're considerate. They're not perfect, but they seek to serve and to love me. What about this? Is your life marked out by loving people who are just like you? I think this is one we all need to think about. It is so easy, so natural, not supernatural, to get along with people who are just like us. And certainly, it's a gift from God to have good friends that may be like you. But do we love others beyond that? Do we sacrifice, hang out with, show kindness to those who are not like us? What about when you look at social media? Does that stir up love in you? Or does it create judgment, condemnation, and scoffing at those who bear God's image? What about in the church, in the body of Christ? Do you show up to love your friends within the church family or to love the family of God? Do co-workers see you demanding your own way, or do they see the love of a servant's heart? Diagnose your heart. Repent in prayer of your sin and pray for the Holy Spirit to help you walk in love. This is the good news. Jesus not only promises to forgive us of every sin of the heart, including murder, he promises to empower us to obey his commands through the Holy Spirit. He says, here's my way of righteousness, and as you turn toward that, I will give you my Spirit to walk in that good way. He doesn't command what he doesn't enable. And we can be a people who does far more than merely not murder. We can walk in love. Love is the fulfillment of the law, and there may have never been a better time in our lives to shine the love of Christ into a world that is needing love right now. And I'm not just talking about this generic good vibes type love. I'm talking about sacrificial action in the spirit of humble King Jesus. I mean that. If we go into this fall and into this winter, we don't know societally what's going to shake out and what's going to happen. There's going to be opportunity for all kinds of division and complaining and bitterness. But we, the followers of Jesus Christ, can shine the good love of Christ into this world. And I'm praying, and I'm hoping, and we need to be praying this verse, that all men we will know we are followers of Jesus if we love one another. Lord, we thank you for your word, ever true, ever true. There is not one word written in Scripture that is not applicable. Give us wisdom. Give us the ability to walk in love. Hold our tongues when we aren't walking in love, and unleash our tongues to proclaim the sanctity, the goodness, the beauty of life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining us online this morning. Just a reminder, we're meeting outside every Sunday at 9 a.m. If it rains or if there's bad weather, we'll meet inside here in the church at 9, and the announcement will go out through the church email and on the website and by the church app. Thanks.